start by telling you right now, I'm not here to teach you how to lie, all right? But I am here to teach you what lying looks like, at least some of the aspects of lying. I'm not going to be able to give them all to you, but I'll give a lot of them to you. What I'm also not going to do with you today is teach you to be a lie detector. What we're doing instead is giving you an idea of when someone doesn't appear to be telling you the truth, and what do you do when you see that? Okay, what is it you're looking for, both verbally and non-verbally, to make you understand if someone's being truthful? So I'm not going to spend a lot of time going through my bio. You guys can see that online. We've got a short period of time and a lot of information to cover. But as Shireen said, I've got over 20 years with the agency. I still have a very close relationship with the agency, do a lot of work with them. That's all you need to know for that. All right. So. My goal today, as I said earlier, is to give you some ideas of what lying looks like. Now, every one of you in this room probably have an idea of what you think a lie looks like, right? People do things, they say things, our gut tells us that they're not being truthful. Well, I kind of want to start our program by having you take a look at this young lady. This is Jamie, all right? And you're going to hear a short interview that I did with her. It's about 2.5 to 3 minutes. And at the end of that interview, I'm going to want you to tell me whether you think she's being truthful or whether she's lying. Fair enough? All right, let's take a look. My first question for you, Jamie, is what involvement did you have in the company's recently discovered fraudulent accounting activities?
Oh, none at all.
Did you ever direct Mr. Glenn to backdate any contracts?
No, of course not.
Prior to the recent audit that uncovered these accounting irregularities, did you have any knowledge that Mr. Glenn was backdating contracts?
No. I mean, if I had knowledge about that, then I would speak up and say something.
Is there any reason that a forensic computer review would uncover any communication with Mr. Glenn regarding this matter?
No, of course not. I don't have any communication with him regarding this at all.
At any time, did Mr. Glenn ever reveal or discuss his efforts to manipulate the company's accountings with you?
No. If he had, then I would have told someone. Fired him, gotten something would have happened if I knew anything.
Jamie, why should we believe that you're not involved in this matter?
I've always had a very good reputation with the company. I have no enemies in the company, no one, you know, I've always done my best, and I believe that I have a very good reputation with that. And people trust me, and I would never do something like that, especially for something that I've worked so hard at.
What do you think should happen to the senior manager who directed Mr. Glenn to backdate these contracts?
He should be fired and go to jail, and there should be serious consequences.
Would you be willing to certify in writing that you had nothing to do with these accounting irregularities?
Yes, of course. I'll sign it right now.
Okay, so a little background, in case you didn't pick it up in the video. We were called in to do an investigation in a company where there had been some fraudulent activity. In fact, this Mr. Glenn had been backdating contracts. And the reason for it was that the company was getting ready to go to an IPO, and they wanted to make everything look as good as it could possibly look. All right, Jamie was one of the people that we interviewed. All right, so the question, as you think about it right now, how many of you think that Jamie is the one who directed Mr. Glenn to backdate those contracts? Show of hands. How many think she's guilty? Nice and high, nice and high. All right, and the rest of you think she didn't? Is that what the rest of you think, or you're just not really sure? Okay. Who over here said you thought she was guilty? Why?
Well, she seemed to fidget him a lot, I guess. Okay. She'll make an answer and then, like, do a motion.
Okay. Okay. Did you guys hear that? The fidgeting, the way she answered the questions, she rubbed her face. I saw another hand. Okay, a nervous laugh. Okay, what about a couple of you who didn't have a problem with her? What did she do that you liked?
She categorically was always saying, no, I didn't do it, no, I didn't do it. Her idea for how the person should be punished was actually quite severe.
Okay.
It just seemed like there was no evasive, worried that she might get caught in a lie later, double talking to it.
Okay, good, yes. Ah, okay. All right, fair enough. So what I wanted, yes?
I was going to say she also didn't elaborate. She didn't try to add a lot to it, but she answered very specifically.
Okay, all right. These are really good answers you guys are giving me. Now, which one of you are right? The ones who think she was guilty or the ones that think she was not? The one that thinks she was telling the truth?
Guilty.
Neither. Okay. All right, good. What I want to do is spend the next few minutes and go through some of the behaviors. And what's interesting is all of you that just spoke talked about the behaviors, some of the behaviors that we want to look at today. So your guts are telling you the right thing, sort of, but it's the way that you're looking at it, and I want to help you do that. Why do people lie to us? They lie to us because they're trying to keep themselves out of trouble, right? I bet you I've got two or three people sitting in this room that would tell me that they never tell a lie. They're the most honest person they know. They never tell a lie. The behavioral scientists tell us that people lie an average of 10 times a day. Okay? Now, I know you're sitting in here going, not me. Right? What about the last time somebody said to you, how are you today? And you had a splitting headache because apparently, like Shireen, you drank a lot last night. Okay? How many of you say, fine? Right? You say, fine. That's a lie. And it can be a lie of omission, but the point is, it's a lie. So how do we look at things? The things I'm going to go over with you today are the keys to success and spy the lie. We want to know what that lie looks like. We're going to talk about analyzing versus speculation. We're going to talk about managing your bias. And every single one of you in this room have a bias. You might not be aware of it, but you have a bias. We're going to help teach you how to recognize evasiveness. Are they answering the question? Are they covering it up? We're going to talk a little bit about aggression. I want to make sure that if you learn nothing else today, that you understand the difference between conveying information and convincing us of something, because that one right there is the one that really gets us every time. And then finally, we're going to talk a little bit about nonverbal cues. Fair enough? So what I want you to do for just a second is I want you to turn to somebody in the room, somebody you might know or might not know, and I want you to be really rude and point at them. Okay? I know it's rude. And I want them to know... we don't have a lot of time, all right? I want them to know that you're pointing at them, all right? With your other hand held really high, I want you to tell me 0 to 5 or more how many times you think that person has lied in the last 24 hours. Okay. All right. Okay. All right. Okay. Hello. Okay. You can put your hands down now. Put your hands down. Okay. Let me start by saying that you guys are a really, really polite group. All right? Because I go places and I ask that question and I've got magic fingers. You know, people are 5, 10, 15, 20 times a day. All right? People will lie to us when it is in their best interest. Whether it's your clients, whether it's your employees, whether it's your supervisor, whether it's your significant other, and of course our kids, because we know they're going to lie, right? But the point is, people will lie to you when it's in their best interest. So let's take a quick look at analyzing versus speculation. One of the problems that we have, and somebody talked about fidgeting, which is fair, right? In any sort of conversation, in any sort of interview, people are going to move. We have to count on that. So I don't want to ding somebody or say that person's being deceptive simply because they're moving, all right? That's what we call a global behavior, a global evaluation. Let's see. This gentleman right here, what's your name?
Ryan.
Ryan. Oh, Ryan moved. Go back to what you were doing a moment ago, Ryan. You were sitting like this, right? If we take what we've been told that this means closed posture, means that somebody's not listening to me or not interested in what I'm saying or doesn't believe in what I'm saying, a lot of people would call that a deceptive behavior. But he may be sitting that way because it's comfortable. He may sit that way because he's cold. Just may be his habit. That's how he sits. I don't want to ding him for that. So I'm going to ignore global behaviors. That's the most important thing. What I'm going to do instead is I'm going to pay attention to when that person fidgets and when that person gives me a verbal deceptive behavior. All right? So in other words, I want the behaviors that I see and hear to be in direct correlation with the question or the stimulus I toss out. In this particular video, the stimulus was, and you didn't hear it on the tape, but it was, I'm here to talk to you about direction of Mr. Glenn and backdating contracts. Okay, that's the stimulus. It can also be a question. I want my behaviors to happen when I throw out that question. Anything that anybody does outside of response to my question is unimportant to me. It's a global behavior. I don't want to pay attention to it. What I'm going to rely on instead is what we call timing and clusters. That's the key to our detection of behaviors, okay, or detection of deception behaviors. So when I ask a question or toss out a stimulus, what I want to see in that first 5 seconds is one of the deceptive behaviors, right? It's got to start in that first 5 seconds. Now, why do you think I say that first 5 seconds? Why can't it start 10 seconds or 15 seconds out? Why is it five? Pardon me? They can correct themselves, but the real reason is we think really fast. So the average person talks 130 to 150 words a minute, all right? We think way faster than that. In fact, the behavioral scientists tell us we really can't gauge how fast we think because we don't think in sentences, we think in concepts. So if I say to somebody, if I ask a question and I don't see behaviors until maybe 10 or 15 seconds out, I no longer can be sure that that behavior I see and hear is correlated to my question. Does that make sense? Because their mind's gone off to something else. Maybe what's my next question going to be? That sort of thing. I want to know those behaviors are resultant in my question. It's really important. And then the other thing that sets us apart from some of the other folks who talk about behaviors is we want clusters. We want two or more of the deceptive behaviors that I'm going to show you, or some of the, there's a lot more, but some of the ones I show you, I want two or more of those behaviors in order for it to be deception. And the reason for that is a whole bunch of us in this room have habits, we have pet phrases we use and that sort of thing. I don't want to ding somebody or say they're not being truthful with me because of a pet phrase. Make sense? So we're looking at timing and clusters. First behavior has to start within the first 5 seconds. Once I see that behavior, any of the other behaviors, I'm going to count as part of my cluster. All right? So if we think about what I just said, it's got to be two or more behaviors, and it's got to be, the first one's got to start within the first 5 seconds. So there's our 5 seconds. Everybody in the room is very bright. They know what 5 seconds looks like. Okay? But if I said first behavior has to start within the first 5 seconds, and any other behaviors after that can go on and on and on. Listen, I'll tell you what, I've sat through management meetings with some corporations. It's amazing how long a CEO can tell a lie. I mean, it could go for minutes and minutes and minutes, all right? But the point is, I want that first one to start within the first 5 seconds. So if we look at this chart here, and if I say it's got to be a cluster, and I need my first behavior within the first 5 seconds, do I have a deceptive answer here? Okay, all those V's and the N's and the V's, those are nonverbal and verbal behaviors. Do I have a cluster? I do, right? Trick question for you. How many behaviors are in that span that you see? Anybody got a good answer for me? How about seven? Now, I've got a nonverbal that happens before I finish asking the question. Okay? Again, mine's going faster than I can talk. If you've got a deceptive person, they know you're going to ask that question in some form or fashion. They're ready for the answer. Okay? The problem is, in this particular situation, that was a nonverbal behavior. It might have been a movement. okay? It might have been the hand to the face that you talked about a little while ago. The point is, it started before. It started within that first 5 seconds. Now, just a little, kick it off a little bit. A preemptive strike, answering the question before I finish it, is not necessarily a deceptive behavior, okay? They could say no because they know what the question is. That doesn't make it deceptive. It's whether they show me one of the, show or say one of these behaviors I'm going to talk about to whether I count it. I count that one that's the outlier there because it's part of my cluster. So I ask a question, I watch for the answer, I put myself in what we call L-square mode, which is really hard to do. It means you're looking and listening with every fiber of your being, and your body is not going to like you for that. Your brain is not going to like you for that because we're not wired that way. But I'm paying really close attention when I throw that question out, and I'm looking for the behaviors. As long as I keep seeing deceptive behavior, I'm going to start keep counting those behaviors for my cluster. Once I've finished everything I need with that question, then I'm going to my next question, and I'm putting myself back in L square, and I'm looking to see or hear whether I see there's any deception. Make sense? So we agreed that this is a deceptive answer. All right. I taught you about managing your bias. The first thing we want to do is to ignore truthful behavior. There's a couple of reasons for that. If you ask somebody a question, let's just use your kid for example. You come home, your kid's done something wrong, all right? Because they're kids, they've done something wrong. They got cookie all over their face. You ask them whether they had a cookie before dinner, and they say no. Okay, you've got the proof, but we're going to let them play their game, all right? If you ask them a question, maybe that cookie's from 3 hours ago. They just didn't get the crumbs out of the side of their mouths or something. You ask them a question and they start being cooperative with you, and you start to think, okay, maybe they didn't. Or more so with your clients. You ask them a question and they start to give you an answer. You like that client. You've always liked that client. But maybe the client's feeling a little bit different these days. You're not quite sure where the relationship is going. They'll lie to you. It's in their best interest. They still want your ideas. They're going to lie to you. But you like them. So, and you see truthful behavior because they've said some things along the way in the past that you liked. You're going to start buying into that lie. You're going to start buying into it. Truthful behavior is really hard for us. If you're focused on truthful behavior, you're not focused on deceptive behaviors. You're looking for something that makes you feel better. Try to get rid of it. It's like taking a drink of water out of a fire hydrant. It's too much coming at you. Throw the truthful behavior out and just look for the deceptive behavior. And again, it guards against that halo effect. I really like that person. All right, recognizing evasion. Have you ever asked someone a question and they've talked for 10 minutes and not said a thing? Okay? I know a lot of people like that. You ask them a question, you want a specific piece of information. Do they give you that piece of information or do they just talk? I'll tell you what, that's part of what you saw with Jamie. All right, you ask her a question and you look to see whether she gives you that answer, and she doesn't always give you that answer. All right, but we'll talk about that in a little bit. Failure to deny. The most important thing for the truthful person is to be able to get that denial out. That's what's important. They want to get it out and they want to make sure you hear it. If you ask somebody a question and they don't answer you, they don't say no or yes, all right, but usually no, it's huge. It's big. It's really something you want to pay attention to. And then we have what we call exclusionary qualifiers. That's where they carve something out of their answer. So for example, what's your name?
Sarah.
Sarah. If I were to say to Sarah this morning, Sarah, do you like what I'm wearing? Okay. Well, thanks. What if I had said to her instead, do you have a problem with what I'm wearing? And she goes, not really. Not really. I'm not sure I like that answer. I like yes or no, I don't have a problem at all, but I don't like not really. So it means there's something about it she doesn't like. Exclusionary qualifiers beg for a follow-up question. So my follow-up question to Sarah, if she'd said not really, would be, well, if you had to pick something about it you don't like, what would it be? Okay, that's my follow-up question. Those are the opportunities you don't want to give up. You want to be able to ask those follow-up questions. But you got to listen for those exclusionary qualifiers because they sound good. Okay, I remember, I don't know if any of you guys remember Computer Associates, and Sanjay went to jail for a very long time. During an interview that he did on TV at CNN, he said, fundamentally, we're not doing anything wrong in our company. Whoa. What's the follow-up question there, right? Okay, well, outside of that area, what are you doing wrong? Okay? So, and again, he went to jail for a very long time. But the point is, it sounds good. Those things sound good, but they're not. Aggression. The aggression behavior, any of these aggression behaviors I'm going to talk about, are the biggest ones. Okay? If somebody attacks the question, or you ask someone a question, and they attack you, that's huge. That's huge. You know, if you ever listen to earnings calls for hedge funds and things like that, they'll ask a company a question, and a lot of times that CEO will go right after that person, all right? And I've heard them use some pretty bad language on those earnings calls. The reason is, if they attack you, what's our natural inclination in a professional environment? It's to back off, right? We don't want to cause problems. We back off, and that's why they do it. All right? So if they attack, that's huge. If they attack a third party, you know, you guys are, you know, the media, somebody, you know, you're asking a question and you know, somebody, whomever you're talking to comes back with, you know, you people are always bugging us, all right? You don't get the truth, you don't understand what's going on, you write what you want to write, and they start attacking the situation, okay, as well as the questioner. And then an inappropriate level of concern. Somebody said earlier, she giggled. Jamie giggled, right? It was inappropriate for that. When we talk about an inappropriate level of concern, it's both levels. It can be that they don't take something seriously enough, or it could be that they're taking it too serious. It's a simple question, and they go from 0 to 180 in a second, all right? This is the really important one, though. The differentiation between convincing and conveying information. A convincing statement is a statement that people will give us to explain why something is the case it is. If you ask somebody, did you misrepresent anybody in that article? Okay, you wrote an article, you don't like the person, you slanted it one way, and somebody asks you if you did that. Instead of you saying no, you go, I wouldn't do that. Okay, I'm a professional. This is the way I felt. Did he say no? He didn't, right? I did it for him. Okay. The point is, nobody answered that. All right. I got to really roll fast. All right. So a convincing statement is the things that people say to convince us of something versus convey information. Referral statements is when people refer back to what they've said before. You know, as I said previously, as we said in our last statement, as we said in our last article, those are referral statements. Invoking religion is huge. It's a big one. And in this day and age, with all the political correctness and we're all trying to do all the right things, somebody throws God into it, whatever your God happens to be, we have a tendency to back off. Okay? When I first started out in this business, that's the one that beat me. Because I was raised in this real strict family and you just didn't do anything wrong. Well, if somebody was going to throw God at me, I was definitely going to go with it. Okay? They were telling the truth. I got beat pretty bad. Somebody went in after me to talk to the person. And again, it was, you know, the same sort of question, have you done anything wrong? And he invoked religion. Again, they kept talking to him and finally got the confession. So he threw religion in and it worked for me. Hasn't worked since. That's the one thing people say puts the hair up on the back of my neck. My son, he's 16. If I had a dime for every time he says, I swear to God, Mom, in my head I'm going, busted, okay? Busted. So perception qualifiers are things that people say to dress up the lie. Things like to tell you the truth or frankly. Those are the ones that people have a lot of pet phrases saying. So those are the ones we definitely want to make sure there's a cluster. Nonverbal cues, behavioral pauses. You know, a lot of times people will restate the question that you ask them, but sometimes their brains don't move fast enough and there's a behavioral pause. Those pauses are big. The nonverbal verbal disconnect, they say yes, they shake their heads like this, or they say no and they nod. It's hard to catch that. If you're in L square and can catch that, it's huge. It's really big for you. Anchor point movements, those are the things that are anchoring you to the chair or the ground. Those are your feet, your bottom, your back against the chair, those sort of things. Those are the things that we want to make sure people do after we ask the question, okay? I don't care if they do it for the whole half an hour. I only care that they do it once I've asked a question. And grooming gestures, you know, they fix their tie, they you know, smooth down their jackets, that sort of thing. And then the hand to the face is a big one. Okay? The reason for that is physiologically based. What it means is that when somebody gets in what we call the flight or fight syndrome, the blood vessels at the ends of their extremities shrink, causes itching. So it makes us go to our nose, our ears, you know, our fingers sometimes. So that's the purpose for it. You want another shot at this woman? You want to look at it a little bit different? We're going to run a little late. Is that okay? Okay, I'm going really fast. So.
My first question for you, Jamie, is what involvement did you have in the company's recently discovered fraudulent accounting activities?
Oh, none at all.
Now watch your feet. Watch her go to her nose.
Did you ever direct Mr. Glenn to backdate any contracts?
No. No, of course not.
Inappropriate. Feet are moving again. That's an anchor point I'm talking about. So another deceptive answer.
Prior to the recent audit that uncovered these accounting irregularities, did you have any knowledge that Mr. Glenn was backdating contracts?
No. I mean, if I had knowledge about that, then I would speak up and say something.
Convincing statements. If she had just said no, she'd have been fine, but she gave us convincing statements.
Is there any reason that a forensic computer review would uncover any communication with Mr. Glenn regarding this matter?
No. Of course, I don't have any communication with him regarding this at all.
One more and then I'm gonna stop it.
At any time, did Mr. Glenn ever reveal or discuss his efforts to manipulate the company's accountings with you?
No. If he had, then I would have told someone, fired him, gotten something. Something would have happened if I knew anything.
Okay, I'm gonna stop it there just because of time. But you see, you're starting to see the convincing statements. All she has to do is say yes or no. All the other people that I interviewed, I got a yes or a no. With her, I got convincing statements. We like sometimes when people give us a lot of information, but it's not the right thing, okay? It's to convince. Sometimes people will do it only one. They'll do one convincing statement. That's fine, because that's not what? A cluster, right? It's just one behavior. So that was really fast. These are the keys that we talked about earlier today. Oops, keep going, Jamie. Oops. Okay, well, anyway. If you want the whole training session, we do have a couple books out. We have one called Spy the Lie, which gives all of our behaviors, all of them. It gives a bunch of scenarios where we've actually applied it to places. And then the second book is Get the Truth. That's once you've spotted the lie, how do you get them to tell you the truth? Okay? I'm not selling the book. I'm just telling you it's out there if you want it. Okay? Shireen, save me. Okay.
Thank you. That was great. I think we can squeeze in one question. We have one from the audience. I think there's one up here. Wait, there's a mic coming. Oh, Trisha, Trisha, no, Trisha, Trisha, over there.
Sorry, we communicate a lot in email now and on the phone. We don't have as much face-to-face communication as we used to have. And so how can we leverage what you've just sort of talked us through in those situations?
It's a great question. And the first thing is, yes, you lose most of your nonverbals because you can't see what's going on. However, you can hear the chair squeaking. You can sometimes hear them moving stuff on the desk. So you can get that sort of stuff, but you have to really, really, really be focused. So what you're really going to pay more attention to are the verbals, what they say as far as you know, in an answer to your question. What you have to be careful of in phone conversations, though, is what we call mental drift. You're starting to think about what your next question is going to be, how are you going to get them to tell you what you want them to tell you, and you stop being in that L-square mode for that time. Okay? Got to stay in that L-square mode.
Good question.
All right, quick.
How do you, like, in that, Jamie would be understandable. Let's say she was innocent. She would be, I would think it would be understandably nervous being accused of that. How do you differentiate between nervous behaviors of an innocent person versus someone who's guilty?
Another excellent question. Because nervousness, it's through the entire thing. So you're looking at global evaluation when you look at nervousness. Look, I interviewed 42 people for that investigation. And every one of those 42 people were nervous. Where it comes down to is, when do I see that? So I'm looking for those behaviors in that timing and cluster aspect that we're talking about. Nervousness, I can weed out the nervousness just based on looking for deception. Okay?
Awesome. Susan, thank you so much.
Thank you guys.
This was awesome.
Thanks. Thank you.